Good morning and welcome to this virtual Easter Chapel. We are so glad you could join us today. On Easter Sunday, Christians around the world celebrate the resurrection of Jesus and the core Christian belief that in this life, love conquers hate, light overcomes darkness, and joy and hope surpass all sadness and despair. This morning, we will hear reflections by two students about what Easter means to them, as well as reflections from faculty and students on where they find hope and joy in their lives. We are grateful for all of our speakers, as well as the student musicians and singers who will share their gifts of voice and song with us. We hope that today's chapel brings hope, joy, and light to your day.
Let us pray. Christ, you are risen with the sun. You are light in darkness. You are peace and hope and joy. You turned defeat and failure to victory for all. You live eternally. May we rise again to new life and find our true place, bringing healing and reconciliation to this wounded world. Help our hands hold the sick and the suffering. Help our feet to walk with the poor. Help our ears to listen to those who live in despair. May our eyes be affixed upon the hope of the empty tomb, so that we may live as resurrection people. Amen.
An Easter Invitation, written by Anne Seidal. We are not eyewitnesses to an event, as were Mary and the disciples. We have not journeyed through a dangerous city to seek answers or consolation. We have not seen angels gathering at the rim of this day, or wept in the garden this morning because we could not find him. But we are here to attest to a story that has not lost its power during 20 centuries of change and conflict. We are here because those before us carried this story as if it were precious gold, cherished it as if it held the key to a hidden wisdom. Sisters and brothers, let us take our places here today in celebration and in awe. What you are about to hear has the capacity to change the world. Your very presence attests to the rising up of life from the tomb of despair and to the boundless power of God. It is Easter, and we will celebrate.
After the Sabbath, as the first day of the week was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord, descending from heaven, came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. For fear of him, the guards shook and became dead like men. But the angel said to the woman, "Do not be afraid. I know that you are looking for Jesus, who was crucified. He is not here, for he has been raised, as he said. Come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, he has been raised from the dead, and indeed he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him. This is my message for you." She left the tomb quickly with fear and great joy, and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them and said, "Greetings!" And they came to him, took hold of his feet, and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me." Here ends the reading.
As a young child waking up on Easter Day,
I would dress up for church in my white dress and would wait with overwhelming anticipation for the egg hunt that was to come. Eager for the search of colored eggs speckled across the garden, I would envision the gleaming foil wrappings of the countless chocolates I would soon eat on the warm stone steps of the church. Growing older, the candy seemed to become less and less important, and I was able to think and understand more of the meaning behind a day as sacred as Easter. Easter is the day that Christians remember Jesus' resurrection from the dead, 3 days after he was crucified. He had died for all the sins of the world, past and present, and his resurrection granted hope for his second coming. Easter is a symbol and a reminder that hope is eternal, and that every day in our lives has meaning. His resurrection is a glorious reminder that, in the midst of hardships and challenges, hope is a unifying guidance force for us all. Hope can propel us in the smallest aspect of our daily lives, but it can also ground us when we are faced with overwhelming feelings of fear or worry. Hope can give us the necessary strength to persist when we feel discouraged or scared. The resurrection of Jesus brings hope for humanity and teaches us how to embrace life. It brings new appreciation for our relationship with others. We find hope amongst our friends, family, and our community. During such difficult times, it is now crucial to offer each other hope to persevere. A quick smile to peers or teachers before class begins can relieve the burdening feeling of helplessness. A brief conversation every day with our friends can help limit the distance between us. A warm meal shared with our families can renew the sweet laughs that once filled the walls. We hold each other up, and together we remind each other that the hope that was once given to us through Jesus' selfless sacrifice will help us endure challenges. Today, we are blessed to commemorate Easter, so thank you and Happy Easter.
As a Catholic, Holy Week and Easter bring both religious and non-secular traditions. While egg hunts, Easter candy, and indulging in the classic Irving Berlin movie musical Easter Parade are all synonymous with the holiday for me, I also find the Easter season as a time of reflection. Holy Week can be difficult emotionally. The Palm Sunday Mass puts the parishioners in the position of the people who vied for the death of Jesus. Attending this Mass as part of the mob is difficult. Shouting "Crucify Him" is not easy. But the Palm Sunday Mass offers an important lesson and a crucial point of reflection. As a Catholic person living in the modern day, how can being in the position of someone who wanted Jesus to die inform my life? When I am living day to day, how can Jesus' situation during his final week of life help me navigate my own life? I ask these questions not expecting an answer, but seeing the suffering that Jesus faced and the resilience he showed as an example of how I should live my life. I think the lessons of Holy Week are especially applicable during this pandemic. Experience Holy Week and the somber services remotely remind me of our current times, uncertain and filled with suffering and pain. But despite our current challenges, it is important to have hope and faith. Palm Sunday and Good Friday are sad, painful masses, but there is always something to look forward to, Easter and the return of Jesus. The observance of Easter brings the joyous celebration of life and renewal. I think about this quarantine situation like Holy Week. Our country is moving slowly through Holy Week, and while it may feel like we have been stuck on Good Friday for a long time, it is important to find ways to reflect and consider people's hardships while also focusing on the good. I am hopeful that Easter morning will bring us all the start of a renewal.
Happy Easter nights, Coach Liptak checking in. A New Englander at heart, I've always relished in the cycle of the seasons. That feeling of a fresh start is just so thrilling. From the little nuances, like different color palettes on display in the store windows, or the Starbucks feature Frappuccino, to the big changes, like the chance to embark on a new athletic season with a new group of teammates, or starting a new arts rotation, or auditioning for the next performance, each season brings with it a tidal wave of hope and joy. The spring, in particular, inspires joy whenever I step outside. I love finding each color of the rainbow in the flowers. Bonus points if you stop to smell each blossom. Closing my eyes to soak up the spring sunshine and inhaling the smell of fresh-cut grass. Savoring the flavor of a succulent strawberry eaten right off the vine. These idiosyncrasies of spring inspire hope and spark joy. I also find joy in human connection, even if it looks a little different these days. Smiling at a passerby, waving hello to a neighbor, or sharing a nod of encouragement with a fellow runner. Creating new connections is still possible. My roommate and I have been using our free time to chalk up a storm on our block. The chalking itself has been therapeutic, brainstorming fun ways to spread joy and gratitude. Our phrases are as simple as, "Don't stop believing," or "Smile, it's free." But then hearing our neighbors read one of the sidewalk messages out loud, or seeing someone take a picture of my bubble letters, feels like I'm still doing my part to make the world a little brighter. It's the perfect reminder that we're all in this together. Have a great Easter night, stay safe.
Just thinking about spring brings me joy. Smelling the sweet scent of the flowers outside Cummins at the entrance to campus, being in the sunshine, hearing the familiar and distinctive sounds of softball and baseball season, sitting outside my classroom with students as they make a mathematical connection and their faces light up, welcoming the newly admitted students to campus, preparing the current classes to move up, and celebrating the seniors who are about to graduate. And of course, Easter, being with my family in church as the triumphant sound of brass instruments blend with the organ in celebration. There is no denying that this spring looks different. I have found that I am on a screen more than before, teaching class, talking with friends and family, watching the news, getting absorbed in social media, and playing games. Earlier this week, a post from one of my bishop's classmates drew my attention. She wrote about how this period of time can feel hopeless, but she made a connection between Holy Week, Easter, and the time we are living in that resonated with me. Life, she posted, is interrupted by devastating loss and then infused by hope in the resurrection. Whatever your faith, I encourage you to find hope and joy this spring in ways new and old. I find hope in ping pong matches with my boys and their various competitions into the pool. I find hope in trying new baking recipes and the sharing of old favorites with my students. I find hope in games of Scattergories and trivia over Zoom with my family near and far. I find it in organizing old photos and recognizing how much our seniors have grown since they were in sixth grade. I find hope in the smiling faces of my colleagues and advisees. Our family finds hope in trumpet recordings and impromptu karaoke sessions. My classes find hope in our collective excitement of mathematics and in sharing what we notice. Math is a lot about observation, and this Easter at home provides an opportunity to really see some things we often take for granted. The birds and flowers around you, neighbors who need a helping hand, family time together. It is also a time to acknowledge the hard work and sacrifice of so many who are working to keep us safe and healthy. This Easter will be different for all of us. However, there is still lots of joy to be found where we are as we hope for a calmer time when we can gather together again in person.
Hi, my name is Clay Peckham, and I'm in the class of 2026. When Reverend Simopoulos asked me last month if I would give a talk about what brings me hope and joy for the Easter Chapel, I immediately said yes. Then I realized I would have to speak in front of the entire school. If you know me, you know I love to talk, but that sounded overwhelming. Now I wish I could be with all of you, because it would mean we would be back together at school. A month ago, the things that brought me the most joy were playing and watching sports and spending time with my family and friends. Little did I know, all of these activities would come to a screeching halt. My baseball and lacrosse games were canceled, March Madness was called off, and Major League Baseball was suspended. We stopped coming to school and weren't allowed to go to friends' houses anymore. So, where do I find joy now? I play video games with friends online and spend time with my family. Our normal lives are busy, and this has allowed us to slow things down and find joy in the little things. Finding hope has been more difficult. We're seeing so much suffering and sickness that hope is hard to find. I do have gratitude, though. I'm now thankful for waking up in the morning, knowing that God has a purpose for me that day. Maybe that purpose is just to play hours of video games and still be nice to my sister, but it's still something. While working on this talk, I stumbled upon a quote that I really think sums up this whole topic. Joy is what happens to us when we allow ourselves to recognize how good things really are. And in this difficult time, I'm choosing to focus on the good around me so I can find joy and hope. I encourage all of you to do the same.
Happy Easter, everyone. When I think about where I find hope and joy in my life, I always think of my friends and family. I'm sure that's the same for many of you. During the COVID-19 pandemic, the relationships that I have with my friends have grown stronger, and the communication with my family has made the social distancing much easier for me. Nowadays, the hope I find is in the optimism from loved ones and the communication with them. No one wants to be in the situation that we're in right now, but it's moments like a nice call from my grandparents or an inspirational quote sent from a friend that helped me find hope in this depressing time. Ironically, social distancing has me craving more contact with my relatives. Almost every night, my family and I will FaceTime my cousins, and every day we'll FaceTime my grandparents. We didn't do this before COVID-19. The frequent calls bring me joy because I now realize more than ever that I'm very lucky to be able to have these calls due to the fact that many people in the world have lost loved ones or cannot connect with loved ones during the coronavirus lockdown. Also, any chance that I get to talk to my friends makes me joyful because I cannot see them in person. Social distancing has brought me loads of stress because I feel that my life, as I used to know it, has crumbled in front of me. Even though I cannot do my daily routine normally anymore or see my friends, I try to make it as normal as possible by talking to my friends all the time. Instead of being sad during the day, I find joy in little things, such as quality family time. For example, I've gone on long walks with my family, I've played board games, completed puzzles, played with my dog, and my ping pong table has been in constant use. If you have trouble finding hope or joy nowadays, I suggest just calling up a relative you haven't connected with in a while and strike up a nice conversation. Trust me, it will spread joy to others and will help you find hope through their words. Thank you, and I wish you all the safest Easter.
I used to think that setbacks were rare occurrences. I thought that once you recover from them and write plenty of journal reflections, you're good for the next bit of time. I found, however, that testing experiences in life are as periodic as ocean waves and just as natural. Amidst a lot of stress, it's easy to feel like I've never had a moment to breathe. But in between these crashing waves, I realized there are lulls of air and sunlight, and they rejuvenate me for the next waves to come. I had trouble at first when writing this speech, finding the exact relationship between gratitude and hope. Gratitude's important. It fuels happiness and peace and satisfaction, but sometimes I have trouble feeling it independently. Sometimes I feel guilt instead. Guilt relies on comparison, such as feeling guilty for having parents when a friend of mine lost theirs. And while it contributes to gratitude, I don't think it's the healthiest place to root gratitude in life. I do think gratitude can build on itself, and practicing loving little things can reflect my appreciation for the bigger blessings in life. I like to think that every little thing I'm grateful for is a whole universe in itself that represents all of the indescribable forces for which I'm grateful. Throughout a lot of deaths and health problems in my family in the past 3 years, I started to think that if I don't experience an immense paranoia of losing everyone around me, if I forget someone's name that night while I'm praying, then I'll lose that person, and I mistook that fear of being imperfect for gratitude too. Gratitude shouldn't be rooted in fear of making a mistake. It flourishes in faith, in positivity and hope that I won't fall under the waves. Hope is kind of like preserved gratitude. It's the faith to hold my breath, hold on to gratitude under turbulent circumstances, and know not to give up on it. Someone in Star Wars once said, "Hope is like the sun. If you only believe in it when you can see it, you'll never make it through the night." It's this tenacious optimism that makes the sunlight and air all the sweeter during the lulls. In theme with the hoarding mentality of our nation right now, I'll say that gratitude can build on itself and grow into something spectacular. So when you see a new wave swelling over your head, find gratitude in the small universes around you. Stock up on the durable positivity and know that sunlight and air is always within you and awaiting you ahead. Thank you.
Hey, Bishops. I'm Drew, if you don't know me, and it truly is an honor to be able to share my reflection with all of you. When Reverend Simopoulos sent me an email about reflecting about what gives me joy and happiness in my life, as a second semester junior, I was a little surprised. But when I really thought about it, a lot of things came to mind. It's easy to become lost in the madness by placing our happiness and joy on external and material results. And as someone who is all too guilty of doing this, I think I've reached a point where relying on grades and scores to provide me with happiness is overrated and simply just not worth it anymore. And I think I found the most joy and happiness now in the moment. And what I mean by that is not worrying about the results of activities, but rather diving deep into them and enjoying what we're doing right now. Whether it means re-binging Friends or eating my body weight in Oreos and other stuff from Costco, not worrying about what we're not doing and living in that moment. And more specifically, when we engage in an activity, whatever it might be, to lose yourself within it and not think about anything else. Every stress-free moment we have is precious. And I think at the end of the day, looking at the amazing opportunities that we all have and the school we attend, we're gonna be okay. We're gonna be more than okay. We're gonna be well prepared for the future. So when it comes down to joy and happiness, I implore all of you to stop worrying about the results and really enjoy each moment we have guilt-free. Thank you so much.
People that have a positive energy bring joy and happiness to my life. In the spring, particularly because of Easter, it's a good time to revitalize ourselves and reflect on what makes us happy. This should involve surrounding ourselves with those who care the most for us and bring the most happiness into our lives. I hope you can use this time in quarantine to reach out to those who have been there for you and send them love.
Hey Bishops, I hope you're all healthy. My name is Liam Ram and I'm a senior. In this awkwardly unique time of our lives, all of us are naturally invited to contemplate how we want to spend our time. We have recently rounded out the end of a very exhausting break where many of us disassociated from our daily routines and the very concept of time altogether. I have found that by being home alone, I've begun to understand myself in ways I haven't before. Although this time has been difficult for me and has at times left me feeling vulnerable, I've discovered that I've grown a lot more comfortable with isolation. I know I exhaust this topic a lot, but last year I lived abroad in China and found that culture shock's inevitable presence affected me in a way I didn't expect it to. Yes, I missed home while I was in China, but by being the odd one out, often feeling isolated from the world in a foreign country, I began to see myself in ways I never had. I realized I was gay, I realized I loved writing, and I realized that I did not like eating chicken feet. Through the inner conflict I experienced in isolation, however, I discovered that true happiness comes from within. I love late night runs to Mr. Frosty's and miss going to the beach with friends, but nothing can surpass the elation that one experiences when they accomplish something great or are looking down over the city that lays before the mountain that they just climbed. I find myself truly satisfied when the happiness that I feel in my life arises from deep within myself, whether that be when I succeed in something or take care of myself. There isn't a better time than now to remember that we should matter to ourselves and that we need to check in with our minds and our bodies to better understand what we want from life and what we want to accomplish so that we can feel true happiness. If you need some guidance, Mahatma Gandhi offered that happiness is when what you think, what you say, and what you do are in harmony. He is telling us that when we do things that we want to do rather than what others want us to do, true happiness arises. Yes, study hard, focus on your future, but what do you want your future to look like? I often think that I can use this time that I've been gifted to check in and notice how Gandhi's quote applies to me. On my last day at Bishop's, before we went virtual, I rented out two books from the library. When I finished one of them, I felt proud of myself. I opened a new sketchbook that I found in my closet, but it wasn't until I drew in it that I felt happiness. Sometimes, doing simple things can also bring us happiness. Leave your room, go to the kitchen and cook something, jump on your computer and learn a language, write a poem, complete things that excite you. Not only is this the best time to do things that we have always wanted to do, but it's also the best time to discover our own inner happiness and unravel what brings us joy. Over the next couple of days, weeks, or months that we live in solitude, we can discover our authentic selves and find ways that we can make a meaningful impact on the world. Thank you, happy Easter, and happy Passover.
Hi guys. Today I'm going to sing a song for you from a movie called The Prince of Egypt. The music and lyrics are written by Stephen Schwartz, who you may know because he wrote Wicked, the musical. Today I'm going to do something special because this is for Easter Chapel. And normally my family would get together for Easter. My dad and I are both church musicians and we work really hard in the weeks leading up to Easter. But as I'm sure you can imagine, this Easter is a little bit different. So we're doing all that hard work from inside our houses and from far apart from each other. But I found a way to come together with my family in a way to share this with you today. So I asked my younger sister, who is at home with my parents in Santa Monica because she was sent home from college, to sing this one with me. So I hope you enjoy this rendition of When You Believe, featuring myself and my sister, Maddie Kornicek. Enjoy.
now for an Easter blessing. The light of God surrounds you. The love of God enfolds you. The power of God protects you. The presence of God watches over you. Wherever you are, God is, and all is well. And may the blessing of God, the God who created you, who loves you, and who travels the way with you, be with you now and forever. Amen. Happy Easter to all, a blessed Passover to all. Go in peace to love and serve one another.